Okay, welcome everyone. I'm Grzegorz Ekiert. I'm professor of government and director of the Center for European Studies. I also have a pleasure of chairing the Zaleski Lecture Committee, and this is 2012 August Zaleski Lecture in Modern Polish History. August Zaleski was a prominent Polish economist, politician, and diplomat, and he served twice as the Minister of Foreign Affairs of Poland, and then was the President of Poland in the Polish government in exile after 1947. And Zaleski Lecture was established in 1983 by the bequest of the Zaleski family to make the Polish history and Polish politics the integral part of the intellectual life at Harvard University. And indeed, this series was very successful in bringing to Harvard the most prominent historians working on Poland, but also very important Polish politicians. So our speaker today was behind this great success, because Roman for many years ran the Zaleski lecture series. Before I introduce our speaker, let me acknowledge the support and cooperation of the Davis Center for Russian Studies and the Ukrainian Research Institute in co-sponsoring this event. You know, as you see, at Harvard, the Polish-Russian and Ukrainian relations are extremely good. And we feel deep affection to one another, and we are very happy to do things together as things like this lecture. Let me introduce our speaker. We are really honored and delighted to have you here, Roman. Roman Szporluk is Mykhailo Kruszewski Professor of Ukrainian History Emeritus and Professor of History at Michigan University, where he taught before joining Harvard faculty. Roman was a global intellectual before it was really possible. So he received his MA in law from the Maria Curie Skłodowska University in Lublin in Poland, then his bachelor degree from Oxford University, and then his PhD from Princeton. I got too excited about this. No, of course. You know, thinking sort of East Coast. But you travel away from East Coast as far as possible. So yes, indeed, PhD was from Stanford University before starting his position at University of Michigan. His research focused on modern Ukrainian, Polish, and Russian history. He's also astute commentators on the current political affairs in the region. His best known work and contribution is to the study of nationalism and to intellectual history. His seminal books include the one on political thought of Tomasz Masaryk, and then the great volume on communism and nationalism, Karl Marx and Friedrich List. The next book was on Russia in Ukraine in the breakdown of the Soviet Union, and he is working on the really seminal history of modern Ukraine. We all wait impatiently for that book to come. So truly, we could not imagine the better and more distinguished speaker for that series. Now, Roman's lecture is on relationship between Poland and Ukraine in between 1795 and 1991. And Roman's lecture will be followed by a brief comment by Alison Frank. Alison Frank is professor of history at Harvard. Her research is on modern Central European and East European history. She's the author of prize-winning book, Oil Empire. And we are delighted that that Alison is joining us for that event. So Roman, it's great honor and pleasure to invite you to that Zaleski lecture.
Grzegorz. I am greatly honored by being invited to deliver this year's Zaleski lecture. And I feel especially happy that in the audience there are so many people I know, some people I will not mention because by mistake I might fail to mention some others, but I see also the person who is joining us, which is Mrs. Weintraub. And Mrs. Weintraub has been for years, she is a member of the Zaleski family, and she has been for years the real power behind the Zaleski committee. Because when the Zaleski committee was proposing someone, she was double checking whether it is politically correct choice. She consulted with Professor Vandich, and then she was told, well, it's all right, you can invite this person. So I am greatly honored, Pani Profesorowo, that you are present here. As I say, I should be mentioning many other people and say how, as I say, how proud I am to have been associated with the Zaleski Committee, with the Zaleski Prize, and also by your presence. But let's go to work because it's getting late. We shall have also, and this is another reason for me to be so proud and honored, our discussant is a scholar who has written a book in Ukrainian and Polish, or Polish and Ukrainian history, modern history. At the same time, this is a work which places these two countries, these two nations in global history. So indeed, she is really on the up to date on the most modern, most serious approach to history. So I am hope she will like my talk. But even if she doesn't, being so tactful and kind, she will probably say something nice about it. Or so I hope. So let's go to work. I am a man really of not 2012, but more in spirit of 1912. So I still cannot both talk and press buttons to make some points on the stage, on the screen. So I have chosen to, I've asked, and the staff of the Center for European Studies was very kind. There are still some seats, please. Have been very kind to make those maps, and I think these maps will tell you, will make it possible for you to see what is the message, what kind of points I try to make. I will occasionally refer to them, but the working map, the one which is probably most important for my talk, is the one which is here, because it will, I will running ahead of my time, but I need to run ahead because we need to remember the time. The point I will be making sometime from now on, maybe 15 or 20 minutes or maybe earlier, is that the making of modern Ukraine, the idea of a modern Ukrainian nation, was born in what is marked here as autonomous Ukraine, which means under Russia. It was not called autonomous Ukraine at that time, of course. It was called Little Russia. But, and this is the punchline of my talk, and in no way should it be taken as a critique of a book which was devoted to the clash of civilizations. I would never do that. My point is that the modern Ukrainian nation was invented in the Orthodox part of Ukraine, and not in the Catholic part. And it was the Orthodox Ukrainians who had to work hard to persuade Catholic Ukrainians that they should become a modern nation. Contrary to the common view that Ukrainian nationalism was invented in Galicia and then spread further east. In reality, it was invented as far east as you can go in Ukraine, and then later tried to persuade Galicians, who resisted it for quite a while, to become Ukrainian. But I'm running ahead of time, but I do say on purpose, because we sometimes talk too much about some digressions and forget to make the main point. So even if you walk out from this lecture in 10 or 15 minutes, you will already know what I try to tell you. Okay. So let us begin really where we should. Okay, my starting point is that something very strange. Oh my God, there is a Zaleski lecturer here in the back, Professor Polonski. I did not see. Wonderful. I'm greatly honored to see you too. Okay. On December 1st, 1991, a referendum took place in the Ukrainian Soviet Republic approving the independence of Ukraine. In a popular vote, a very overwhelming vote everywhere, there was a majority. Of course, majorities were bigger in some parts than in others, but in every area, in every this region, a vote was for. And then on December 2nd, the first country to recognize an independent Ukraine was Rzeczpospolita Polska, the Republic of Poland. Russia spent a sleepless night and recognized Ukraine on December 3rd. Poland did so on December 2nd, and I am using these facts as a takeoff point in order to reflect on the fact, why was Poland the first? And I want to suggest that this recognition was an act of recognition, not only of acceptance of the emergence of a country called Ukraine, but of the acceptance by the Poles. And let's leave Russians now for a second, because you know, Russians might deserve an extra hour, and we have no time for them now. It was recognition by the Poles of the transformation of Poland. You see, I am obsessed by the idea, and I'm presenting it in various published and unpublished papers, that the making of one nation amounts to the unmaking of another nation. If you are following the current stories from Spain, you will probably notice that if Catalonia becomes independent, or people who want an independent Catalonia are people who want Spain to be unmade, the kind of Spain that exists now. Because those people are saying, yes, let there be Spain, but it has to be without Catalonia. If Scotland becomes an independent country, Great Britain will become something else again. So my thesis is, and that's my obsession, I have been working on it, finishing my book for the past 20 years. I have been finishing this book about the making of modern Ukraine. And in that book, I am arguing that the making of modern Ukraine is the story of the making and remaking, obviously making of Ukraine, remaking of the old autonomous Ukraine into this Ukraina Irredenta, which would include all those things which you have on the map, one of the last map. Just try to think about it. How long does it take, how easy is it to move from that little place called autonomous Ukraine here to that map in your handout which shows the situation now, after 1991. Quite a story. But to make that kind of country, you have to remake or unmake both Russia and remake and unmake and transform Poland. And so the event of December 2nd, 1991 is an extraordinary event in the history of Poland as well, because an independent Poland accepted the extraordinary changes on its map that took place since 1772, because in the Polish minds throughout the 19th century, the map of Poland was the map of 1772. After 1918, the map of Poland was the map of 1921 or 18 or Versailles-Riga Treaty, in other words, that map. Then came horrible stories about which we all know, very bloody history of the 20th century, and then something happened, and a free, independent Poland supported Ukraine, and it did so not by recognizing it on December 2nd, 1991, but working very hard for years and years before to help the Ukrainian cause. So my thoughts, I am not attempting to present a history. It's not, I used to enjoy teaching history 101 or West Civ from Plato to NATO and all of those things, but I will not give you a talk, I hope, on that level, but rather will focus on a special side of the story, namely the story of the Polish-Ukrainian-Russian triangle, because Ukrainian secession from Poland and Ukrainian secession from Russia was also very powerfully influenced by the Polish-Russian conflict. May I give you away again a concluding thought from my talk now? I think, so I will not have to go over those notes at the very end, or not all of them. In order to understand the story of the making of Ukraine and the Polish, the Western Ukrainian front, Am Westen viel Neues, the relations with Poland, it is necessary to remember the fundamental mistake the Russian state and Russian society made with the partitions of Poland and after. They failed to understand how important Poland was. I will have some good quotes about it later, but I want to make. So the big geopolitical mistakes that led to the destruction of Russia, to Russian national suicide, as Professor Pipes has told us in his book about Struve, where he quotes Peter Struve describing Russian revolution as a political suicide of political nation. I argue, I am convinced that on that road to political suicide, Russia, the Russian misjudgment of the importance of Poland played extremely critical role. If Russians did not waste so much of their energy in building Russian Orthodox churches in Warsaw, did you know there were over 40 of them in Warsaw in 1914? Try to imagine. In trying to teach Polish peasants to become Russian, try to imagine that, anyone who could. If they had not done that, perhaps, and devoted more attention to Ukrainians or even Russians themselves, perhaps this triangle would have produced a different result. So much for the triangle. Let's move to Poles and Ukrainians. Polish historian, whom I will quote in Polish. I hope there are some people who understand Polish here. I will still, of course, translate. I apologize for my Polish. I belong, after all, to an ethnic minority in Poland, so we were always having trouble with good Polish, but I will read it. Losy Ukrainy i Ukraińców splotły się z naszymi w stopniu bez porównania większym niż losy jakiegokolwiek terytorium i jakiegokolwiek narodu. The fates of Ukraine and of the Ukrainians have tied up, splotły się, to a degree beyond comparison with any other, higher than those of Poland with Ukraine. And a second quote, this is from Władysław Serczyk, but now I will quote from Jan Kieniewicz, but I will paraphrase because, you know, it's getting late. The Polish-Ukrainian conflict reaches as far east as the expansion of Europe. The dramatism and emotional tension of the Polish-Ukrainian conflict are consequence of its intra-European character. And that, as I say, is one of my leading theme thoughts. The formation of modern Ukrainian national identity was connected, was due to the fact that Ukraine had been in the sphere of influence of Poland in the early history, before 1795. You know, when you give a lecture like this, a century more, a century less, it's not important. So we can go a little bit back, and I want to argue that, in fact, the experience of Ukrainians, as they were not then called, within the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, introduced them to European institutions and ideas, and that they, even when for reasons we cannot discuss, they did not work out, a deal within Rzeczpospolita did not work out, Ukrainians went under the Tsar, they remained political children of the political ideas of Rzeczpospolita. But, let's make one more point, that Poland about which we are talking should not be seen as an East European country. We know there are all those debates, and maybe in discussion time we shall come to it, the invention of Eastern Europe, which is a masterpiece, and as a debate, what is Eastern Europe, what is Central Europe. My thesis, my view is, Poland was not that Poland with which Ukrainians had their troubles, was not an East European country, even if then even Polish roads perhaps slightly were less good than in the Rhineland, or the hotels in Paris were more, shall we say, elegant than the hotels in Warsaw. That Poland politically, as a civil society, as a nation, was basically as European as anybody else. There is a contemporary Ukrainian historian called Jaroslav Hrycak, who argues that, in fact, you can compare Poland, 16th century Poland, or 1500, 1550, to Britain, to England and the later Britain. In other words, the concept of a nation that was independent, that was not totally dependent on the state, the idea of contract, of pacta sunt servanda, of legal rights, neminem captivabimus sine jure victum. We shall not capture any, we shall not punish anybody unless convinced by law. The Poles like Latin very much then. This is a Polish principle. That places Poland in Europe, not in Eastern Europe. I hope Poles in the present company will like that idea. but I happen to think that actually it's correct. So that is, sorry, what's happening? You are disagree? Yes, okay. Very good. So let's move quickly to things. In making these points have been made by a whole generation of historians, including some who got their PhDs at Harvard University. I will not name them all because, again, I will forget someone and it will be taken thing. There were students of people called Omelan Pritzak, Viktor Weintraub, Edward Keenan, Ihor Shevchenko, and so on. And they have rewritten, this is a side remark, but premeditated digression, they have revised the Western historiography by showing precisely that Ukraine is not just part of some of the no man's land between Poland and Russia, that in fact it had several centuries in its history where actually Protestant Reformation was winning their supporters among Orthodox, where colleges were being founded, and so on and so on. And among those people whom I would like to mention now is, of course, another Harvard professor, late Ihor Shevchenko, the great Byzantinist, but also a historian of Ukraine and a native of a suburb of Warsaw, as in the Ukrainian family. Shevchenko wrote a lecture called Poland in Ukrainian History. You can see where I am borrowing myself my title. And he pointed out precisely that without the, while Ukraine, of course, owes a lot to its Orthodox connection to Byzantium and all the rest, the East, it also, there would have been no Ukraine. Well, let me quote. When we view things from the vantage point of Eastern Europe, to be sure, without Byzantium, there would have been no Ukraine or Belorussia. On the other hand, without Poland, there would have also been no Ukraine and Belorussia. I repeat, I don't say that all of this was the great inventions of Poles because they were Poles. My point is that when we say Poland, we mean European. Europe. Poland was the Europe Eastern Europe knew, but it was not a second-class Europe, it was Europe. If I were using the Soviet language of Soviet Marxist-Leninist terminology, I would say there was Polish form and European content in what was happening in Eastern Europe. So Shevchenko then made the point, that in fact, when Ukrainians found themselves finally under Russia, those East Ukrainians, pre-partition, which was after the Battle of Poltava, they within Russian Empire still remained not entirely assimilable to the Russian imperial identity. So what happens then? We need to move, okay, before we move on to Ukrainians under Russia, one final point, of course, which I can only register that you should know that I know about it. Of course, Ukrainians themselves were the reason why an independent or Ukraine did not become a part of the Polish-Lithuanian Union as perhaps a third member was due to a variety of factors, social. All of those things were wonderful, we are talking about, but to be a peasant was not great fun. There was also the geopolitics, which involved also the Ottoman Empire, for reasons beyond, you know, we obviously have to ignore Ottoman Empire, but we know that the course of those wars was very much influenced by the fact of the presence of Ottoman Empire. Still, Poland did manage, after the secession, the Russian-Polish partition of Ukraine in 1667, ratified 1686, Poland managed to persuade the Uniates, those Ukrainians who switched to the subjection to the Pope, basically managed to persuade them to become political Poles. So something which is left out completely from Ukrainian history surveys. I have a bad word for everybody, so I will also say something about Ukrainian historiography. One of the fundamental errors of Ukrainian conception, generally adopted Ukrainian conception of modern history, is that after the partitions of Poland, Ukraine was under two empires, Austrian and Russian. That's all wrong. Ukraine remained in the Polish sphere even after the Polish state ceased to exist. And the point which is overlooked in surveys of Ukrainian history, which is very, because in consequence of that conceptualization, is that in the last decades of the Rzeczpospolita, roughly after 1772, although it actually begins even earlier, in the 60s, there was an extraordinary cultural and political and intellectual revival in Poland, defined as Rzeczpospolita, prior to the final partition. And in that revival, ethnic Ukrainians, but they were not defined by nationality, they were Uniates, were most eager Polish patriots. Amongst the most enthusiastic supporters of Tadeusz Kościuszko in his struggle for independence of Poland were the bishops and clerics of the Ukrainian Uniate Greek Catholic Church. Ukrainian historians don't like to mention it because, as we know from that Frenchman who said it more than 100 years ago, to be a modern nation, you have to agree not only about remembering certain things, but also about forgetting them. So Ukrainians have agreed to forget that they were killing each other just as enthusiastically as they were killing Poles and Jews during those great revolts of 17th and 18th century. Of course, Poles and Jews remember it, and rightly so. Ukrainians chose to forget it because if they are going to be together, they cannot remind each other what they really did to each other in 1648. So as some historians have pointed out, the actual memories of people who witnessed the events of that time have become totally rewritten in the 19th and 20th century. So I finished that section of my presentation by simply saying that Poland was very successful in denationalizing those Ukrainians who remained within Rzeczpospolita. They became peasants, they became servants, some became Polish nobility, but anyway, there was no Ukrainian national problem, and people who read Ukrainian history can wonder, how is it that in 1772, when Austria occupied Galicia, nobody among Ukrainians was saying, we are finally liberated from 400 years of Polish occupation? They did not have that sense of liberation. There was no joy of liberation from Polish rule, because they would discover that they had been under Polish rule only 70 years later, in 1848. Because in 1772, those who had political ideas were Polish. Those who had pre-modern ideas accepted new ruler by God's will, the Empress or Emperor of Austria, and everything was all right. So that was a great Polish story, success. But then Poland was, Eastern Ukraine was under. You are looking a little worried. How many minutes do I have?
Please go ahead.
May I go ahead? Okay. And nobody is still walking out, so I think I can. All right. Okay, so let's go ahead. So what happened to autonomous Ukraine, which finally ended under the Tsars? Because Russians, in Russian textbooks, because Russian textbooks also are not accurate, Ukraine became dependency of Russia, or it was reunited with Russia in 1654. It really did not happen. First of all, not all of it. There were long wars, conflicts, triangles, quadrangles, and so on. But by 1686, it seemed to be fixed. What happened to that area? That area retained an autonomous status as a kind of entity which had its own laws, had certain institutions which were totally missing in Russia proper. Obviously, it was a special arrangement, and the Tsarist government did not like it. So the next 100 years, it was gradually eliminating it. Quoting my favorite Russian historian, Mikhail Pokrovsky, about whom I wrote my doctoral dissertation, I would like to mention that in Pokrovsky's phrase, the next 100 years were the story of a gradual elimination of a state character of Ukraine and its transformation into a province with some special features. So the Russian government basically succeeded by doing this by the end, but the question arises. if Ukrainians, Orthodox Ukrainians, learned so many clever things from the Poles, who were Catholic, but they're not only Catholic, they were Protestants, they were Calvin, you know, people were having all sorts of religious conflict, why did Muscovites, Russians proper, did not pick up some ideas from Ukrainians who had all those Polish, watered down Polish ideas? Why did this not? So it's a very big question about which, of course, we cannot talk except expressing a few Russophobe opinions. One of those opinions was, and I am really becoming more and more attached to this thought. Everybody quotes all the time Jeffrey Hoskin. Britain had an empire, but Russia was an empire, and perhaps still is. But you know what some more modern Russian and historians are saying? Russia was not only an empire, Russia was also a colony. When you think about it, of the Tsarist state, when you think about it, Ukrainians say how mean Russians were to them in the 18th century. But just think about it. Ukrainians in autonomous Ukraine had more autonomous institutions than did Russians in Russia proper. And now we get to even a more important point. There was no Russia proper. The Tsarist state, especially after its union with Kazan, but even before, gradually destroyed whatever was left of what we would call Great Russia, Russia proper, ethnic Russia. And the destruction of that, the expansion of the empire, was not accompanied by the retention of some sort of core Russia. When I used to teach still classes, I used to tell my audience, after Scotland and England formed a united kingdom, there still remained an England. After Great Britain became an empire, there still remained a Great Britain. So everybody knew that Edinburgh is Edinburgh in Scotland, and Manchester is in England. People knew that still remained, there is a Wales, and then there was India and South Africa and so on. But nobody had a confusion about what is England, what is Britain, what is the British Empire. In the case of Russia, this was not so. The Tsarist monarchy was a colonial regime also over Russians themselves. And that prevented, it was impossible. There was no society called Russia proper, which could become, which could pick up stories, lecture, lessons from the Ukrainians. Because if Russian Empire was to introduce some reforms of the European type, was it going to extend them to Kazan, Siberia, wherever? You, to have a Russia becoming European, you had to have a Russia proper. I will come to this in a minute. Let me only mention now that some current Russian historians, for example, political scientists, Dmitry Trenin and others, are telling us precisely how it was the empire of Peter the Great that was actually destroying Russia. And think about it, empire of Peter the Great. He moves the capital of his country outside the historic territory of Rus, of Russia. He establishes the capital in an offshore location, Ingermanland, taken from Sweden. It had no Slavic, no Russian, no Ruthenian, no Kievan, no Byzantine connections. And to make his point, to rub his point in it, he gives it a very nice Slavonic Byzantine Greek name, Sankt Petersburg. So what Peter does, he is the great Europeanizer of Russia. He certainly models his buildings on Amsterdam and London and so on, but it does not occur to build, to him to build a city hall in St. Petersburg, to establish a municipal self-government. On this, St. Petersburg remains behind Kyiv, because Kyiv has it even under Russia, because it got it from Poland. So we have here a very interesting story. We have to try to explain why did Ukrainian separatism emerge in the Russian Empire, and it's the area which is in. To make my story extremely short, but at least to remember to make my points, I would say the empire was very successful in accommodating the Orthodox clergy in Ukraine. These guys, unlike Russians, they knew Greek, they knew Polish, they were very educated people. So the clergy, the churchmen, begin to make phenomenal careers in the Russian Orthodox Church. That's one. The upper class of the Cossack Ukraine, people who are descendants of Cossack leaders who now persuade themselves that they are a nobility, they accept Russian rule because they actually, even though their grandfathers may have been peasants, they enjoy the idea that the peasants under their control will become now their serfs. So the upper class of Ukrainian society embraces, rather likes Russian Empire, likes Tsardom, but they fight for the right to be equal of Russian nobles. But as I say, they don't really worry about the peasants. They don't treat their peasants any way better than the Polish landlords treated Ukrainian peasants in older days. So, you know, that's there. However, there were some of those nobles who wanted to be, as I say, recognized as nobles, and in doing so were invoking the alleged real or inventing all sorts of documents. This is a time of grating, to prove that they had been of noble class. But involving those, bringing in those documents of noble class came together with the argument that actually their homeland used to have political rights. So we have a very interesting phenomenon when some pressure by members of the ruling class for its recognition in St. Petersburg as real nobles comes together with some elements within that class who also combine it with political arguments for autonomy of their country. And it is here that something very interesting begins, the beginnings of the Ukrainian intelligentsia. And the Ukrainian formula, I am going to be very brief, but I will still make my points. I would say the making of a modern nation, there is a conventional view by Miroslav Hroch, which is all wrong, but there was a time when I quoted him with approval. But as I say, I'm finishing my book the last 20 years, so I have time to change my mind. The first stage of nation making, as I see it, is the invoking historical arguments. We have a history, and in this case, it's a political history that makes us different from the ruling nation. And here, my favorite text, because the story begins quite early, is by a nobleman government official from Cossack Ukraine called Semen Divovich, whose argument, he wrote a beautiful Russian language poem, that's the Russian language of that time, called A Conversation of Great Russia with Little Russia. And in this conversation, Little Russia is persuading Great Russia that it is not a Russia itself, that while they have one monarch, they are two different nations. And he invokes it by arguing that it used to be a nation under Poland, and when the Poles did not keep their promises, but they had a contract before, it moved under the Tsar and had a contract with the Tsar to become a free country. That's a text, to give you an idea. It was written allegedly in 1760s, but it was not allowed to be published until 120 years later. My point is, the Tsarist censors knew what these texts meant. This was a dialogue of two, a work of literary fiction, 1762. It was published only in 1780s because they surely understood that historical arguments of this kind are really a form of critique of political system then in Russia. So I am, maybe because I grew up in a communist country, and when we understood, when people were saying, let's go back to early Marx or late Lenin, they were really saying, let's criticize the current system. I am convinced that in the 19th century, all this Ukrainian obsession with historical documents, chronicles, which were being fabricated left and right, but also some may have been actually real, was a way of carrying on political struggle with the existing system. There is a very nice quote, I think, by Elias Canetti. Power-hungry men who have no power become historians. Obviously, obviously, present company excluded. But in the 19th century, if you could not engage in politics, you made history. And that's my interpretation of the great Ukrainian historiographical debates of the 19th century. That was the only way to criticize the system. And here I was inspired also by what I learned about Czech history. After all, when Palacki writes that Czechs have a great history going back 1,000 years, he is doing what Czechs understood. We used to be before different. This means we can again be different from the status quo. So that's so much for that. The second big event in Ukrainian nation formation is the invention of a national map. As one historian, whom I will not name because he is present here, wrote, territory is not just a background factor in history. It assures a stable sense of community only when identity space is congruent with decision space. Now, the transition from identity space to decision space is the transition. I hope, Charles, you don't mind that I quoted you. No. No. It's the story of the making of Ukrainian nation. The first modern map of Ukraine, already invented by using ethnographic principles, appeared in a book called Description of Kharkiv Gubernia, published in Moscow and probably written by a Russian in 1780s. It offers the first map of the Ukraine, which the author calls Southern Russia. It includes those areas, includes all of this. It does not mention the south, but basically includes even the territory which was then under Austria. And what is revolutionary about that idea is that the author not only mentions, and he names, Little Russia, Southern Russia includes under Russian Empire, under Poland, because there is still Poland, under Austria, he already knows that there is Austria, and it includes not only Orthodox people, but also Catholics. That is a conceptual breakthrough, which is for the first time brings the idea that Ukrainians are no longer limited to one religious group. Of course, this is an idea before its time. Oh yes, and one very important point. All of this is due to Ukraine's former connection with Poland, because he implies again that it was not just former social, economic, or religious persecution, it's also certain political institutions. Next part of this, and it will is the creation of Ukrainian literature in Ukrainian. It comes at the end of the 18th century. Its founder, inventor, is known as Ivan Kotlarevsky, and he wrote basically, and the point of that, I will not summarize this, we really have no time. What I want to say is that Kotlarewski belongs already. First of all, his biography is totally connected to Poland. He was born in 1769, just as was born that young man in Corsica in 1769. He was 20 years old, therefore, in 1789. He was in his 20s during the second and third partition of Poland. He was 25 during Kościuszko insurrection. But not to make story too simple, in 1812, Kotlarewski volunteers to serve in the Russian army to fight Napoleon. Why? Even though, because he knows, which Ukrainian historians again forget, that if Poland was restored in case of Napoleon's victory, the partition of Poland would have been unmade, and right bank, West Ukraine, would have come back under Poland. And Kotlarewski already belongs to that generation, which already has accepted the partition of Poland, because for them it becomes a reunion of Ukraine divided in 1667. Okay, let's move even faster, although I apologize, I'm so slow. I'm spending so much time. I believe that the partitions of Poland were a geopolitical revolution of European-wide scale. I already mentioned that the Russians failed to understand it. But ladies and gentlemen, Russia, after 1772, and especially after 1815, the Congress of Vienna and that, is a completely new country. We all admire the book by Antony Polonsky, The History of Jews in Poland and Russia. But there were no Jews in Russia before the partitions of Poland. Therefore, Russia, try to imagine, think of Russia, the Jewish question, pogroms, whatever you want to, all of this would have not been there if Poland were not partitioned. So the partitions of Poland made Russia a different country. There were also no Catholics and Protestants except the Baltic provinces. So this is an extremely important point. Second, the impact of Polish partitions, Polish nationalism, was not limited to Eastern Europe. We all quote this famous quote from Lord Acton, that for the first time in modern history, a great state was suppressed, and so on and so on. Acton did not say that partitions of Poland inspired nationalism in Eastern Europe. He said they inspired nationalism in Europe. We forget about it. You know, I'm sometimes wondering, when you really look at the history of 19th century, you find out that the Hungarians knew what is happening in Ireland, that the Irish knew what is happening in Bohemia. There was there was the Slavic Congress in 1848, nationalists of all lands unite, you have nothing to lose but your brains. You have a European-wide problem of nationalism, and the Poles are very much in it. So, again, Poland was not a frontier, but a core area. I was hoping, John Ledan talks about it. Andreas Kappeler, Poles played the leading role in subverting Russian empire. That is the world in which Ukrainians function in the 19th century. If I may have 5 more minutes, what I want to say is that after the partitions, there were Poles who began to rethink how Poland can be restored. And one of them, who I think was a speech writer for Tadeusz Kościuszko, Józef Pawlikowski, wrote an essay called Czy Polacy wybić się mogą na niepodległość? Usually it's translated as can the Poles win independence? It really means wybić się means something more. It means can do it by themselves. And he says, no, they cannot do it by themselves. We need to create a coalition of captive nations. The idea of captive nations was not invented by Cold Warriors after 1945. It was invented by the Poles after the partitions of Poland. The idea that we need to have allies. And he mentions all sorts of captive nations, not only under Russia, and lists among them the proud Cossack nation to the east of Dnieper. He says, of course, everybody knows that Kiev is Polish, but to the east of Kiev, there is still a very, very brave nation which can become our ally. So Mr. Pawlikowski became a spiritual leader, inspired of what I call the Polish Ostpolitik, and this Polish Ostpolitik continued through Adam Czartoryski and a lead number of major figures, in which they already corrected the Pawlikowski point. They begin to think that maybe in order to win the support of Ukrainians, you have to remap Poland. So maybe Kyiv, after all, is not going to be part of a future independent Poland. So that's a very interesting story. And now let's simply close with, again, with a bad word for someone. It, by accident, it's a Russian historian, but that doesn't mean that I favor especially Russians for criticism. Russian historiography, because there are some very good Russian historians who now question it, who say you have to recognize the importance of Poland. But a very influential Russian historian says that in the 19th century, Ukrainians were under Polish nobility and the Romanov Empire. There is a very great French historian who says something very similar. He talks about the triangle, Polish noble, Ukrainian serf, and the Russian official. That's true for social history. What I am trying to argue is that, in fact, we need, yes, there were Polish landlords, but also the Polish revolutionaries, intelligentsia. There were Russian officials and there was Russian revolutionaries. And there were Ukrainian intelligentsia, not only Ukrainian peasants. So yes, it is true, life of peasants was very hard, but there were already intelligentsias debating. Beauvoir makes fun, he says, let me quote. Spośród, my French is very bad, and it's the fault of the Poles, because all French authors I read in my youth were in Polish translation, so I had no need to learn French. Spośród wszystkich ziem dawnej Rzeczpospolitej na Ukrainie panowały najbardziej zacofane stosunki społeczne. Jakaż przepastna różnica między mentalnością Polaków na Ukrainie i mentalnością polskich uchodźców we Francji, którzy w tym samym czasie dyskutowali o demokracji, while the Polish landlords were oppressing Ukrainian peasants. Let me translate. Among the old lands of old republic, the worst social conditions were in Ukraine. The most oppressive, most backward Polish oppression. But what a contrast between what Polish revolutionaries talking about in Paris and what the Poles were doing in Ukraine. I might add that perhaps those Polish revolutionaries in Paris were getting little grants from their fathers in Ukraine to help them to talk revolution while their fathers took care of providing funding for those grants. Anyway, what we need to remember is that, in fact, there were the talks of the French revolutionary, Polish revolutionaries in Paris were not all waste of time. And running again, get to one of my conclusions, I wanted to mention that Polish intellectuals after World War II were also talking about revolution in Paris in the 1950s and 60s. They were working to bring Poles and Ukrainians together Jerzy Giedroyć has to be mentioned here, but he was not the only one. So intellectual chatter is not totally a waste of time, even if the realities are very bad, peasants are poor and are being exploited. And what was happening is that in Poland, or in exile and elsewhere, Poles and Ukrainians began to debate their relations. There is a phrase called nocne rodaków rozmowy. Nocne means night, but it means sort of late night, some kind of nocturnal conversations of compatriots. And these nocturnal conversations of compatriots involved also Ukrainians, or those compatriots who, in result of those conversations, decided not to be Polish. I call it nocne byłych rodaków rozmowy. They were, in the course of their conversations, were becoming former compatriots. I remember from my school years the phrase nocne rodaków rozmowy, but I did not remember where was it from. So I wrote an email to my old friend, colleague, distinguished colleague, maybe friend as a distinguished colleague, Professor Alexander Schenker at Yale, and asked him, where exactly is it from? He responded promptly. It's from the poem by Adam Mickiewicz, Do Matki Polki, to Polish mothers. And that phrase runs. And in a lecture on Poland in the 19th century, you have to quote a Polish poet, right? So I will quote. Zwyciężonemu zapomnik grobowy zostaną suche drewna szubienice. Za całą sławę krótki płacz kobiecy i długie nocne rodaków rozmowy. It's a poem by Adam Mickiewicz addressed to Polish mother who tells her that she better start getting his son learn that he's what waits for him in the future, shackles, rope, wheelbarrow, and early grave. It's a realistic poem, but what I am saying is, in the course of those conversations, Ukrainians and Poles finally worked out an arrangement where they would agree to be two different nations. And as we know, it was a very painful story, but we don't need to mention now the 20th century history. What I want to end with my concept of making and unmaking nations. Those Ukrainians who thought they were Polish, because it must be remembered that throughout the 19th century, there were countless ethnic Ukrainians who were political Poles. Some Maurycy Mochnacki, one of the greatest Polish political thinkers of the 19th century, was the son and grandson of a Ukrainian Greek Catholic Uniate family. There were many more. I sometimes suggest that people should look at the National Bibliography of Poland, a multi-volume national, and look for a number of ethnic Ukrainians who were Polish, prominent Poles in that area. But we are interested in those who decided we shall not be Polish. And my understanding of the making and unmaking of nation is what happens when you become a former compatriot during those nightly conversations. To become a Ukrainian who had been Pole or a Russian before that, you had to adopt a resolution of dependence. Because you could dream of independence, you have to declare yourself to be dependent. In order to become a separate national, you had to commit an act of self-colonization. Because if you still thought you were Polish, you did not know that you were under Polish rule. But when you decided that you would be a Ukrainian, you said, my God, for 400 years we were under Polish occupation. Now, I am not making this example. There is a very famous novel, of course, completely forgotten, but it was very famous in the 19th century, in which a young man, returns from several years in prison, in Austrian prison, to the village, and he talks to an old friend of his, the daughter of a local parish priest, and they talk about politics. And she suggests, reminds him of some of their favorite Polish poems they used to read before his arrest. And he tells her, my dear, you are all wrong. These are not our poems. These are poems by an oppressor nation. We are really victims of Polish colonial rule. We need to liberate ourselves from that. That's the story. And I have been inspired to think about it during my studies in England in the late 50s. There were two students from India in my college, graduate students, and one from Pakistan. And I wondered, why do they have those long night debates? Not narrow, because there were debates, because 12 years earlier, there had been compatriots. And then many years later, a revolution broke out, and one of the most defended, the biggest defenders of Pakistan was that Pakistani friend of mine, who 12 years earlier had been an Indian. And then the revolution broke out in Pakistan. And then I read in the papers that my friend from Oxford is a foreign minister of Bangladesh. In his lifetime, he had three fatherlands. And choosing that, he had to be free from India, and then he had to be free from Bangladesh, from Pakistan. I think the story of Eastern Europe is the story of people changing their fatherlands, committing acts of self-colonization before you can be independent than you need. So the concluding thought is, the Poles played a very major role in the making of modern Ukraine. We could quote the famous ethnic Poles who became great Ukrainians. There was a Polish aristocrat, Austrian count called Roman Szeptycki, who decided one day to become a Ukrainian called Andrzej Szeptycki. One of the greatest Ukrainian political thinkers of the early 20th century was an ethnic Pole who decided to self-colonize himself and become a Ukrainian, and so on. So the story is extremely complicated. But the extraordinary conclusion is, what a remarkable accomplishment it was that an independent Ukraine enjoyed Polish support for so many years before 1991 and remains very much supported by Poland now. And it is also, because Poland is not an East European country, Poland is a European country. Thank you very much.
Well, those of you who know Professor Szporluk know that he is a gentleman of European manners, so he was quite embarrassed to see so many people in the audience whom he would like to thank personally, an impractical matter for him. For me, I have a much easier task, for though I see several people who are responsible for my education, there is only one person whom I must thank today, and that is Professor Szporluk himself. So thank you. Professor Szporluk has given us a talk in which he very modestly emphasized the usefulness of Poland to Ukrainian history, the role of Poles in making modern Ukraine. But of course, those of us who were listening realize, which is I assume everyone, realize that he was equally talking about the usefulness of Ukrainian history to the understanding of Polish history, the role of Ukraines in not only the making of Poland, but in the struggle for freedom in Poland. And I think that his remarks today also enrich our understanding of one of the most, if not the most, important concept or motif running through Polish history, and that is that very struggle for freedom or liberty. He made a few comments about the nature of the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth, the importance of contracts, the regulation of matters of capture, punishment. He could have gone on at greater length about the Polish-Lithuanian Commonwealth as a Rechtsstaat, as a state of law with enshrined freedoms. And from that time until very, very recently, I think we would all agree that there is no period in the history of Poland in which people who called themselves Poles did not struggle for freedom of one sort or another. In the partition period, throughout the long 19th century, which in the Polish case could be said to begin not in 1789, but in 1772, in the First World War, the terrible 20th century, there were constant struggles for the political freedom of Poland. The fact that for many decades the rhetoric of Marxism was and the leap to the so-called Kingdom of Freedom was used to fortify a state system that was anything but free does not render the notion of a social or economic freedom that moves on a spectrum of freedom and unfreedom that was independent of political liberty irrelevant. The relationship between political, national, religious, economic, social freedom and constraint in Polish history was very complicated. One of the central questions, I would argue, in Polish history, and one need to think only of Tadeusz Kościuszko, who Professor Szporluk mentioned several times, who, after serving alongside General Washington in the American Revolutionary War, led a 1794 insurrection against the Russian Empire in partition Poland. He was confident that liberty was on his side. Against the pile of the frightened, already enslaved, he wrote of the Russian forces, or perhaps it was his speechwriter who wrote it, "We oppose the massed force of free citizens who, fighting for their own happiness, cannot fail to prevail." But Kościuszko also knew that Poland's much-celebrated liberty was imperfect. Instead of rushing to join the defenders of the Polish Republic as they fought off Russian invaders, the peasants who worked the vast estates of their Polish lords were just as likely to join in the plunder of the manors. How, Kościuszko asked, could their loyalty be won to the what he called the cause of humanity, justice, and the good of the fatherland? And his answer was to proclaim that every peasant is personally free, but to do so without abolishing the peasant's labor and service dues. How to manage this tension between political and economic freedom, between the liberty of Republican Poland vis-a-vis the neighboring monarchies that divided it amongst themselves, and the liberty of individual men and women in the various lands of partition Poland, is one of the fundamental questions of 19th century Polish history. And it has corollaries in European history more broadly, and even in the history of the Atlantic world. And I was reminded, when listening to Professor Szporluk's talk, of a very famous speech given on July 4th, 1852, I think one of the more moving speeches in American history, by Frederick Douglass. And the title of his lecture was, "What to the Slave is Your Fourth of July?" And one might ask, as a sort of corollary to that, what to the peasant is the 3rd of May, 1791? What was it to the Ukrainian, to the worker, to the servant? Does freedom come from political rights? Can it be guaranteed or rendered immaterial by economic structures? Is it perhaps a spiritual condition? So to think about the history of Ukraine, to add it in, to intertwine it into the history of Poland, I think can help us keep Polish history honest. Honest not only in relationship to the East, to Ukrainians, to Greek Catholics, to the Orthodox, but also to the wide variety of Poles whose own struggles for freedom proceeded alongside and in connection with, but not exactly synonymous with, the freedom of Poland itself. So if we can think of Russia as a colony of the Tsarist regime, we can also think of the Polish peasant, the Ukrainian peasant, waging a struggle for rights within Poland's struggle for rights. We can think in the post-1945 period of Catholics struggling for the right to practice their religion within a Poland that was struggling in other ways to establish a more just state system. The making and unmaking of nations, but also the interlocking struggles for freedom and what the hierarchical relationship of different forms of freedom to one another should be, is a question that can help reconnect the history of Eastern Europe to the history of Western Europe, the Atlantic world, and other parts of the globe. This is a difficult task, but I believe that the path forward has been illuminated for us by this greatest of all practitioners of imaginative cartography and historical geometry, this great drawer of triangles and squarer of circles, my teacher, Roman Szporluk. Thank you very much.
We have approximately half an hour, so let me open the floor for questions. I guess there are going to be a lot of questions, so please keep your comments short, so we can go back to Professor Szporluk and ask him to respond to your comments. So the floor is open.
Well, I clearly have answered all questions, not Professor Collins.
One way of looking at the history of Polish lands in the 19th century is to see the main social phenomenon as being the replacement of the hegemony of the Polish noble stratum by the Polish noble nation, limited as it was, by modern nations, the Polish modern nation, the modern Lithuanian nation, and the modern Ukrainian nation. In a way, this was the approach which you took. It works for Lithuania, but it doesn't work so well for Ukraine because, as you pointed out, the origin of the modern Ukrainian nation is in this autonomous area which went from modern Lithuania to the Tsarist Empire in 1772. So how would you configure this problem when you're thinking of how to write the history of Ukraine in this context of making and unmaking of nations?
Well, thank you for this question. It's a question which we may ask. Can you hear me? Yeah. We may compare the Ukrainian case not only with Lithuanian, but also with the Jewish story, the emergence of a Jewish national movement, Zionism, but in other words, and Belarusian. So you have at least four successor nations of the Rzeczpospolita, in addition to the new Polish nation, because Polish ethnic nation formed in 19th and even more so 20th century is a new nation in many ways. As I like to tell the Poles when I lecture in Poland, more Poles were thinking about Podole than about Opole. And it took a long time before actually the Poles redefined their own country and remembered that they had areas in Silesia and Pomerania they had lost centuries ago and never thought of in the 19th century. So the successor nations are Poles, Lithuanians, Belarusians, Jews, and Ukrainians. The difference of Ukrainians and also Belarusians from the others is that they were claimed at the same time for good historical reasons by the Polish nation and for their own historical reasons, Slavic, East European, Orthodox, by the Russians. So Ukrainians had to fight as it. Russians did not say, tell Lithuanians, you are really Russians. They thought you had to work on them to make them Russian. In case of Ukrainians, they say, well, you are really speaking as corrupt version of Russian. So the war on two fronts lasted throughout the whole history of making modern Ukraine. And what is very interesting, that there were periods when Ukrainians were becoming allies of Poland. But at the same time, there were periods when Ukrainians really were afraid of Polish recovery. There is an anecdote which is in my lecture notes, but which I had to skip. In 1863, during the Polish uprising, which was also in Ukraine, a Polish insurgent talks to a Ukrainian activist, Władimir Antonowicz. His maiden name was Włodzimierz Antonowicz. He decided to become a Ukrainian. And he asked Antonowicz, on whose side are Ukrainians in this Polish-Russian war? Antonowicz said, we want the stronger side to lose. And many historians think that it means the Russians. No, he wanted the Poles to lose. Because culturally, Poles were dominant in Kiev in a way in which Russians were not. So Ukrainian triangle is really a constant triangle which Lithuanians did not face.
Charlie, please.
speak loudly. I'm getting old and here.
Wonderful talk, full of paradoxes, which I have to keep digesting. You shied away from the 20th century. Let me ask a painful question, perhaps, and that is to what extent we have a recent book by a wonderful historian called Bloodlands, which is a different geographical concept for some of the area, or more or less in the area that you discuss. Would you be willing to comment on that conceptualization and what's behind it for your, what you've done with this area of Europe?
Well, I am very much impressed by Bloodlands. I think Snyder wrote a very original, very important, very significant book. The reason why I did not mention the 20th century events, because even I, simplifying as much as I like, I once gave a lecture to a Polish group in Michigan on 1,000 years of Polish history in 50 minutes. So I am not reluctant to cover long periods. But here, I felt that I have to leave the 20th century out, partly because everybody knows about Piłsudski, about 1920, and all of that. But speaking about Bloodlands, I don't know what exactly you are alluding to, but I would say that what I see as one of the reasons why I am impressed by that book is that he tells us the contribution of Russia and Germany, or shall we say Germany and Russia, to the disaster which Bloodlands became. So again, this is an example, with all this nonsense about Eastern Europe. Let's not forget that Hitler was not an East European, that Franco was not an East European, that Mussolini was not an East European. In other words, we have here fascism, Nazism, dictatorships, and the Nazi contribution to the Bloodlands is very important. But again, let us say, what is really tragic, because Polish-Ukrainian history is a tragic story, and maybe this point is not quite, but you can say so much in one book. Even Snyder is very good at making points. You had this global struggle because Hitler's plan for Europe and the world, and the Soviets, Stalin's struggle. And under the cover of that global war, the Poles and Ukrainians were refighting their old wars. And maybe this is the horror story. 1943, Stalingrad, you are moving forward, and Poles and Ukrainians are trying to get prepared for the war they will fight again after Germany is defeated, after America defeats Russia. There will be a replay of Polish-Ukrainian War of 1918-1919. We know this very well, that it was in the underground and in the London government, people were sort of preparing for a repeat of Polish march to Lviv. And after the war, as one Polish historian has just written, there was a very common expectation that a World War III will come. And jedna bomba atomowa i wracamy wnet do Lwowa. Jeszcze jedna bomba silna i wracamy też do Wilna. One nuclear bomb and we come back to Lviv. Another powerful nuclear bomb and we are back to Vilnius. So you see, no, your Polish is much better than you admit. So the point is, there is that replay of old thing. And by citing this, I want to stress again the extraordinary accomplishment of those unpractical intellectuals who managed somehow to persuade the Poles and Ukrainians that perhaps horror stories should be remembered, but perhaps one cannot go on fighting the wars again of 1648 and beyond.
Roman, your story is the story of ideas. It's the story of identities. the intellectuals are the actors on the scene, moving things around. And as far as I understand Alison's comment, she reminded us that there is economy out there, and there is inequality out there. I wonder, where is this place for this in your vision of the nation making and the relationship between Ukraine?
I recognize it very much. The point Alison made, she did it as usual very tactfully, but I did get her message. It is, of course, very important. I would say even more. Clearly, I mean, let's not create some kind of idealized dream of all those intellectuals drinking coffee in Paris and discussing the future of Europe. It's all very nice. They were also in Warsaw and in Lublin, and there were people, that's all very good. But of course, we, a historian, not of ideas, but of real people's lives, has to admit, and I alluded to it, peasants were slaves. Whether they were serfs, whether they were landlords, were Polish or Ukrainian or Russian, they were being treated very badly. We know all the horror stories, and so we know that, and a historian has to admit it. But I would make another point, which I have in my notes, but Alison did not mention it, but I alluded to it when I mentioned her book, that her book is in Ukrainian and Polish history, but is also in world history. The point is, I believe that all national history is global history. And therefore, in order to understand the events, the outcomes, it's Poles and Ukrainians did not do those things which they did in December 91. It was not a conclusion of a logical train of thought, you know. It had something to do with the Cold War. It had to do not only with Yalta, but also with Potsdam. Collapse of the Soviet bloc, Cuba, and all the rest. So in other words, I believe there are two things that need to be added when I talk about intellectual history and remembers its limits. One, historical decisions are not a logical outcome of the inner logic of nation building. We first think we have a history. Then we think we need to start publishing. Publish or perish, or else your nation will disappear. So Ukrainians go into publishing, and start creating a literature. You know, as the Ukrainian slogan was, better read than dead. You have to start having Ukrainian books read, and then you will be a nation. Now, that's all is very nice, but the result, Ukraine would not have become independent, Soviet Union would not have broken up for a number of reasons, which I will not even start mentioning. So yes, but my final defense is, even if it's only 1%, if it's only a fraction of things, the actual outcomes are also influenced by what men and women of ideas, of intelligentsia do. After all, it makes a difference. Yugoslavia did not have to end up in the massacres which accompanied its breakup. And I agree with those scholars who have said that those massacres had something to do with what the intellectuals were saying in decades prior to. So let us recognize there would have been no independent Ukraine without Gorbachev, without perestroika, without crisis of Soviet economy. But there would not have been that happy end of December 2nd without some work by Polish and Ukrainian intellectuals.
Thank you, sir.
Could you comment perhaps on the Austrian wedge here?
Yes.
My father's family is from Ruthenia, and the stories I heard growing up were that Ivan Franco was occasionally a guest of the Franz Josef in jail, but he was allowed to publish, and it's really the Western Ukrainians under Austria who in many ways kind of led the intellectual charge for an independent Ukraine. Is this just a self-promotion of ethnic Ukrainians from Austria, or is there some truth?
As a native of Königreich Galizien und Lodomerien, which was my homeland was known, and I am obviously eager to give credit to Galicians, to Ruthenians in Galicia. But ladies and gentlemen, if you promise not to tell your Ukrainian friends what I told you here, the truth is, in 1772, as I mentioned, the Galician Ruthenians became very happy because Austria improved the status of their religion, of their church. So it made it better in comparison with Roman Catholics. So they were terribly grateful for it. But what Austria did was to destroy the historic entity in Poland called Rus Czerwona, Województwo Ruskie. In other words, what the Polish occupation did not do in 400 years, Austrians did it in one move in 1772. They destroyed the territorial entity of Ruthenia by merging it with ethnically Polish territories to the west of it, this Galicia. They invented a Galicia extending to Silesia, to the river Dniester in the east, which was a total fabrication. They did more to harm Ukrainian potential nationalism than the Poles did in 400 years before. Okay. Then the Ruthenians became very loyal. Those of them who liked monarchy were very happy because now they had salaries, they had, you know, things and so on. They had status and so on. But those who had political ideas were Polish, chose Polish national identity. What Ukrainian historiography underplays or leaves out is extraordinary wave of self-Polonization of the educated Ukrainians after 1770. In 1790s, when in Poland, in Warsaw and Vilna, you have all this exciting life, in Galicia, in Lviv, you have lots of active Polish writers, critics, and so on, who are actually, again, sons of Ukrainian priests who are ethnic Ukrainians. It took Ukrainians several generations to decide that they don't want to. Some of them don't want to be Polish. But in the 1830s, when the first student underground Ukrainian sort of organization emerges, and first people begin to write, historians tell us, Polish historians like to tell this story more than do Ukrainian historians. In the Greek Catholic seminary training priests for the Ukrainian church, there was a very powerful Polish patriotic underground organization. And there were Ukrainians volunteering to fight Russians in the Polish-Russian War of 1831. So the first Ukrainians to say, nie będziemy Polakami, were a very small minority among the educated people. And only in 1848, they suddenly remembered that there used to be a Galicia, a Ruthenia, and they demanded in the Austrian Revolution the partition of Galicia into Ruthenia and into Polish part. Somehow nobody thought of that in 1772 or even in 1795. So we have here a story, but again, we all quote this old clever Frenchman called Renan. In order to be a nation, you have to agree to remember certain things and have to, and I insist even more, he said that, you have to agree to forget that. And as happens, you know, the famous American novels, you know how people invent their biographies in dynastic things. What Galicians did, they became really super Ukrainian patriots after 1848. They did so under the influence of Ukrainian intellectuals coming from Kiev. Shevchenko, Drahomanov, Kulish. It is in the Orthodox Ukraine that a secular Ukrainian intelligentsia emerged and began to influence Ruthenians, Ukrainians in Galicia. And so Galicians became super Ukrainian patriots by the 20th century. And just as in the 1830s, the sons of Greek Catholic priests joined Polish-Ukrainian, a Polish organization, and fought for Poland in the uprising of 1831. In the 1930s, sons of Ukrainian Catholic priests participated in terrorist organizations assassinating Polish officials 100 years later. And then, since Ukrainians were such super Galicians, such super patriots, after 1918, after the great Polish-Ukrainian War of 1918-1919, they accordingly remade their memory. We have been super Ukrainians always, from the very beginning, and those Easterners are just Russified little Russians. So that's how we remake Ukrainian memories. There is a question here.
Yeah, I wanted to push you maybe past the boundaries of even the lecture into the 21st century.
Oh yes, 21st century. I find it very interesting, yeah.
How serious do you think the regional divide that was palpable, at least in the last round of elections in Ukraine, is for the future of the Ukraine? And what is underneath that? Or is it something more profound?
The future, I feel rather sort of uncomfortable talking about the future because I remember my education in communist times when the future was certain and the past was always changing. So, I don't venture to say, but I will allow myself to make a serious point. It has been very common to constantly stress that the real Ukrainian national strength is in the West, and in the East it is all Russified and so on. Ladies and gentlemen, and I've reproduced a map in this handout. There is this little funny map at the very end, from that famous book, which I never would have identified, about the clash of civilizations. It's all wrong, that map. But the point I am making is, yes, West Ukraine is most Ukrainian now. It was under Polish occupation, as the Ukrainians say, in the interwar period. But when Ukrainians were in the Soviet rule, their intelligentsia was physically wiped out. Their peasant class was physically wiped out. There was extraordinary terror. There were killings, deportations, famine again in 1946, and so on. So when we think that Ukrainians in the East are somehow defective Ukrainians, let us remember that their experience in the 20th century was horrible enough that it is amazing that they still think politically at all, that they still think that they could be a nation. So yeah, as for the elections, well, I don't know. We will see what happens. I would only point out that actually in the series of elections, as we move from one, you know, starting with 91 all into our decade, actually, the percentage of those voting, shall we say, for National and Democratic Party in the East has increased, and especially strongly so in the area we call autonomous Ukraine. So let us see what happens. But you know, considering the past, it is amazing that there is a Ukraine at all.
We made a full circle. I have one more pleasant duty, Roman, to present you with a very special medal for the Zaleski lecture.
And medal.
Thank
is
you
there,
so much.
Join me thanking Professor Szporluk for his wonderful lecture.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much. We are going to have a very special Zaleski lecture next year. This is going to be a 30th anniversary of Zaleski lectures, and I hope that you remember about this.
Who is the lecturer? Am I invited again?
This is a big mystery.
Thank you so much.